She will be in conversation with Kanchana Banerjee, whose first book, A Forgotten Affair, is a mature love story. Her latest book, Nobody's Child, is a fascinating crime thriller. I now welcome the esteemed panelists on stage.
Is this okay? This is good? Yeah, I think I just need to hold it closer. This is good. Hello.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Why don't people just, you know, huddle up a little ahead? There are lots of... Come ahead, all of you, if you want, or if you're more comfortable on the chairs. So it's a great way to spend a Sunday out in the open, and thankfully pollution has gotten a little less. So it's nice to be outdoors. And what better way of spending a Sunday afternoon than to talk about love, romance, and love story. And that too with my friend, a very dear friend, Milan. Whose writing I really enjoy reading. I've known her for a while, ever since I began my writing journey, which is not too long. So, and she writes beautifully, and not just beautiful love stories, but also her writing style. For those of you who are not familiar with her writing, you must pick up her books, and she writes wonderfully well. So, Milan, let's get the conversation started.
Thank you, Kanchana, for that lovely introduction. And for those of you who haven't read Kanchana, I must also say that Kanchana has been, I think she's been hugely successful in a very short time. She started off by writing a book that wasn't romance, but yeah, at least it had a little bit of, the genesis of the story was from romance.
Yeah.
And now to thriller. So I'm looking forward to this afternoon, and thank you all for being here on a Sunday.
Okay, so Milan, what is it about this story? What made you write this story, Our Song?
So, I have been in advertising and working as a writer in advertising for over 30 years, okay? And this is like giving away my age, but so be it. But one of the things that happened was that I had trained in music long ago. Enough to be able to at least, adapt that sense of meter and rhythm and so on when I was writing jingles for advertising. And very often you would always write to a certain meter and a beat. I want to write this as a rap, or I want to write this as a march, or I want to write this as some kind of a harmony. So one particular day I was writing a song for a company. It was a corporate assignment. And I had written four songs, and one of the songs which I had written was the one I really loved the most, which was centered around the theme of hope. But that didn't go through. And when I was going to that company's office again, it's on a very, very long elevated road in Bangalore. And at that point in time, sometimes there's always that aha moment, and I'm going on that road, it was really hot, and I kept thinking, imagine if the heroine and her vehicle just breaks down here, and that's the takeoff point from the book. And the song that didn't get through was the song which became a central theme in this book for me.
Okay, so your first book was out and out a love story, Love Asana. And the second one was called TikTok, which was not really a love story, a mature relationship story of a bunch of friends getting together for a reunion. And for your third book, you've again written a love story. So why did you not choose to kind of stick to the romance genre all through? Or, how did TikTok happen, and how did this happen?
The first book was for the under the Milton Boone imprint. And while I was the first Indian Milton Boone author, the fact is that Milton Boone has a certain learning that they have had, which is what makes them as popular as they are. So there was this whole thing of, it needs to be about one male protagonist, one female protagonist. They did not like having secondary characters too much. So those were the learnings that were being given. And despite that, I had fought quite a lot and managed to, you know, say that I can't imagine a story that is set in India which is going to be completely in isolation. So for, you know, the moment I had finished writing that book, I was very clear that I want to write a book which represents even more the India that I know and represents relationships the way I know it. So which is how TikTok with 30 is a story about re-exploring old friendships. And it was about a bunch of 12 friends who come together. It's a reunion. But you're also not glorifying friendship in the sense that when you revisit old friendships, you will find there's lots and lots of old baggage that comes. You know, people who were bullies or who troubled you, or there was unfinished stuff or somebody stole somebody's girlfriend or boyfriend. And there's all the rancor and whatever. And there's also the old protectiveness and, you know, the good things also that come with old friendships. And you can go back to being the same kind of loonies that you are with each other when you come together. So this book started off for me as saying I will write this real kind of a reunion story. But then because I do love romance, so I ended up looking at some romances that had happened when they were in school and what happened to them and, you know, how those people turn out to be 10 years from then, and some new chemistry, which itself was a new aspect to consider. Can you actually have chemistry with somebody who you've known, you know, and you had spent a large part of your growing up with? Can you actually now suddenly develop some sort of an attraction to that person? So that book was going into all those areas.
Okay. And like one thing I must say that I wasn't aware of this about you, that, you know, there is a musical side to yourself. I didn't know that you were trained as a singer and you are pretty, you know, deeply into music, or you were at some point in life. So, you know, can you just tell us something about your relationship with music?
So I think that, you know, I get very surprised occasionally when I come across people who say that I'm not into music. You know, it comes like, how does a person live without music is a surprise to me. Because for me, I'm an insomniac, and most nights I just keep on listening to things on YouTube, and very often if you've liked one thing, it'll say, if you like this, try that. So I keep exploring and exploring and exploring, and I think I've trained my neighbors very well. So up until 3 at night, you know, I don't think anybody is even, you know, raising eyebrows or knocking on your door or anything. They're used to my Bluetooth speaker being on. I trained in Hindustani music as a child, and then there were always gaps. And much later, when I'd had my first kid, I found a guru again who said that you must do your Visharad. Visharad is the equivalent of again doing a degree in music. And I remember at that time saying, but Guruji, I had a pretty decent, successful career in advertising. And I said, but Guruji, mujhe degree leke kya karna? I don't want to go around teaching somebody music, and I'm not looking to perform either. I just want to learn to enjoy music for myself. And he said, nahi bas karna hai, is tarah se tum padhoge iske bare mein. You know, so you at least get to know a little bit more about understanding taal and le, and you know, beyond just somebody giving you sangat.
Okay, so and like while we are talking about music, Milan, why don't you tell our audience as to what is like what is the role music plays in the story? And because I'm sure there are quite a few here who don't know about the book and what it is about.
Yeah, so you know, it was interesting for me to deep dive into saying, is a person who's coming from a creative field, I think not just a musician, but us as writers, people who paint, or people who are involved in the creative or in the arts in any which way, is that person a different person? You know, is the mind of the musical person or the creative person, is it a different mindset from a regular person? And I realized that it is true. You know, there is, at my launch recently for this book in Delhi, I had two musicians with me. I had Sonam Kalra and I had Aditya Jassi. And both of them, who are musicians, they said that, you know, we keep seeing inspiration in the ordinary, in the everyday thing. You know, you just hear sounds and it starts to take musical patterns. And, you know, that is something that defines my heroine in our song, Ragini. It's like even when on the road her chappal breaks down, the kachak, 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 while she's driving her chappal and she's going, is starting to form meters and patterns in her head. Yeah. And even when she is forced to do this particular corporate assignment because she has to pay bills as a struggling person trying to make a career in music. So even in as boring a place as a pharmaceutical company, after some time, those sounds, you know, the heavy sound of the doors, the hum in the cafeteria, the way the utensils sound, all of it starts forming musical patterns to her. And she realizes that she could never have got this had she not been forced to be inside that company for some time. So music, you said, what role does it play? Basically, I used music almost as a character.
If you can just tell them briefly as to what the story is about.
Yeah.
What the book is about.
Yeah. So this book, Our Song here, is a story of a girl called Ragini, who's a struggling musician. And she has come from a really, really rough time where she lost her father when she's very young. Her mother remarries. And her mother remarries her guru. Mother also used to learn music, and that guy is like representing one of the most powerful music families of Pakka Hindustani music in Delhi. And so Ragini, who wants to create her own kind of music, fusion music, is not able to do that. And she finds a lot of patriarchy, she finds a lot of resistance internally from people who are expecting to become the main followers and shagirds. And she is finally humiliated and she goes away to Bangalore to create her own music. And in the course of that, she meets this half British, half Indian guy called Andrew. And he's a guy who has also come from, obviously, all of us. I think that, you know, the stories that make sense today are stories where you're not just looking at boy meets girl and then what happens. You know, you're looking at stories where you're able to see a lot more of what happened in that person's life. Almost everybody is coming with some emotional baggage. You have, let's say, trusted once, trusted twice, and now you've told yourself, whatever I do, I'm never going to trust anybody else again. So Andrew is a guy who has also come with a lot of issues, and he believes only in transactional relationships. You know, if you look at times like today, where most people will say, I'll get on to Tinder, or I'll get on to, you know, hook up with somebody I might have a drink with, and then, you know, you just make it very, very temporary and transactional. And he really believes that love makes you weak, and he doesn't want to do that. So this book is all about how music can cut through the emotional barriers we build around ourselves. And if you would only allow it to. And music can help you get back hope in your life. So the central theme is around hope.
And what I especially liked about the story is that while it is a love story, it's not a stereotypical love story. You have tried to, you know, kind of talk about different issues, you know, kind of sensitive issues like patriarchy, and the protagonist, she's sexually assaulted, you know, like in her guru's home, etc., before a performance. So, you know, would you like to talk a little about, have you done this purposely to tweak the love story into giving it a modern flair, talking about topics that are very now and today?
Yeah, Kanchan, I think when you said like the topic was, you know, is it time for romance to be tweaked? I think what is happening is that there are a few of us, yourself included, and I would say people like Anuja Chauhan, people like Andaleep Wajid, you know, we're writing stories which are not just about somebody and what's happening with them and their love. You know, there's a lot more that's going on in anybody's life. Love doesn't just sit there and, you know, occupy and, you know, take over your entire life. Of course, it's important. But, you know, I think a book that tells a bigger story, it's telling you about the context. And I credit whatever I learned in writing to a great writer called Mahesh Datani, who, like 22 years ago, I had done a playwriting workshop with him, who taught us the entire workshop, you know, the fundamentals of character building, plot building. And I think one of the things that stayed with me, he says, you know, we must write for our times. Unless, of course, you're choosing to write history or in historical fiction or non-fiction. If you're writing for your times, how can I set characters in today's day and age and make them these, you know, singularly obsessed with love people? You know, I would find that a very boring story. I need to give my characters a world that is a fully developed world with interests that occupy them, that they're passionate about. And that tweaking in romance, I think, is therefore already happening. That's one part of it.
And I think it's very important because these stories, you know, I mean, like whether it's a love story or any other kind of story, it kind of mirrors the society we live in. And our stories don't exist in isolation.
Absolutely. And you've done that in Forgotten Affair also, yeah. Kanchana, the way you've taken, you know, this woman who walks out of her bad marriage, you know, that itself is a sensitive plot that is very, very today.
True.
Right?
And she and she doesn't shy away from trying to seek love outside her marriage, which is very much very much a topical thing. I mean, it's not a figment of anybody's imagination that she
wants to. Right. So I think that's why, you know, it's a relatable story. It's a relatable story because your character is not one-dimensional.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we want to be able to do today. And the other thing that for me is a very conscious choice is the fact that I want to make sure that my stories are not the kind that, you know, where you feel everything is written from the male gaze. You know, when a story is written, you'd know it. You know, there are lots of best-selling romances today. And it's also one of the reasons why romances have got so much flack. Because so much of it is written from this whole male gaze of objectifying the female, talking about her sensuousness and her something that. Which is okay, even if you want to say, okay, I will use it to at least build character. But the physicality of the person and so on can only be such a small part of it, you know. And so to stop telling stories which are just coming only from that male gaze is something which I've tried very consciously not to do.
And there's a very, very nice, casual, light-hearted banter between the two central characters, Andrew and Ragini, which I found very, very engaging and very interesting to read. That, you know, she's not a typical love story heroine who, you know, kind of quivers at the knees and just kind of gives away. So, just
would you like me to read that bit where they have me? Yeah, sure.
Yeah, please.
One second. So this is very early in the book where Ragini has been told by Andrew that if she wants to get this project to write the corporate song for the company, she needs to spend at least 2 months and be on campus and just get a feel of the company. It's a pharmaceutical company and she is like bored stiff because everything is silent, everything is white. It's the opposite of, you know, the way a creative person wants to live their life, you know, it's a bit surrounded by a sense of color and chaos and stimulus. So this bit begins over there. A week of hanging around at the Livin'On campus had started to teach Ragini a few things. Most of all, that the place had a rhythm of its own and it played in the sounds around her. The low-key ringtones, the droning murmurs from conference rooms, beeping test monitors, the dull opening and shutting of heavy wooden doors. It wasn't the exuberance of a lively mountain stream hurtling its way down through rocks and steep slopes. It was a deeper sound, more like the fullness of the river in the valley, a joining of streams that didn't individually shout out but merged into a big body of water. There was such a quiet, deep thrum to it. So it goes on to, you know, how now she's hearing the heavier notes, the chatter in the cafeteria, and it reminded her of one particular bandish, a composition that she remembered her father singing in Raga Savari, the todi that had been made epic by Pandit Bhimsen Joshi. In the days, Ragini had been wandering around this world, seeing the deep commitment and optimism with which everyone seemed to work at defeating one illness or the other, made her think of that Raga Savari todi. There was a sweetness in the notes and even a crushing pathos that was almost spiritual. But Andrew seemed to be continuously traveling. So basically, Ragini, I'm just jumping ahead, and Ragini is really, really bored stiff. If Ragini ever happened to ask where Andrew was, pat came the reply, Cairo, Dublin, who knows? And then Angel would follow through, that's his secretary, with a shrug, pointedly looking into her laptop to signal the end of the interaction. Something had to give. So Ragini shoots off an email to Andrew at livinon.com, from finedrags@gmail.com. Subject, reference, discussion. Hello, Andrew, or should I be saying, sir? I have done my homework here. In fact, I'd even say I have done my time, but then there would have to be crime involved before that, wouldn't there? Do you think I could do a jailbreak and you could consider the time I've spent here as atonement for future misdemeanors? The truth is, I need to pace and stroll and sometimes break into a jig or a jog as the day demands, and I need to write my music in an environment that lets colors and lights and imagery through, that lets me plonk down on the grass at hand or on a bench at least. I know this is hard for you to understand, seeing as you have been desensitized by the overabundance of white around you. White doors, white boards, white chairs. Geez, why are there so many white lights too? I don't blame you, but trust me, the only way this song is going to turn out special is if I can get away from this sterile environment. Need to go before I go bonkers. Ragini. P.S. I promise you a spectacular song within a week. And then, before she knows it, there's a reply from him. tofinedrags@gmail.com. From Andrew at livingon.com. Subject reference discussion. Hello, Ragini. First of all, fine drags? Seriously, that's your email ID? Is that your idea of a joke? That people find drags when they come to you? I certainly hope not. The company Silver Jubilee has greater expectations from you. About the lack of color that you write about, I should tell you white is a color in its own right. You could try putting the laptop left for you to use to good use. Try to drag yourself away momentarily from the YouTube channels you're always on. But careful, we don't want that annoying white light from the screen blinding you. Nevertheless, you'll be glad to know that starting this afternoon, you'll be seeing a greater abundance of green. I have instructed Angel to have my car and chauffeur take you home to pack and join me on a tour of Livingon's facilities. There's a care center in Kasauli I would like you to see. The video crew will also be traveling with us so I can bring you all up to date on the care center in one go. I'll use this time on the drive to see how well you have understood my company's many ventures. Best regards, Andrew. P.S. Don't go bonkers. Go pack.
Okay, so Milan and an entire generation of women have grown up reading love stories. But how popular are these love stories amongst the younger generation? So before I ask you the question, I just want to ask a few of the young ladies here. Do you read love stories? Great. What about you in the blue and black? Okay, that's nice. So, you know, Sitara, you don't read love stories. Anybody else would like to comment? Do you read love stories? If yes, what kind do you like reading? Yeah, please. Okay, great.
Oh,
Wonderful. What about the ladies in the front? Do you enjoy? You're not a fan of love stories. Okay. So Milan, you know, like this brings us back to the question that are love stories really popular today? The younger crop of readers, say like your daughter, she's about 20 something, she's working. Does she read love stories? If yes, what kind does she read? So what is the future of love story writing or love story novels in India today?
You know, I've argued with a lot of my fellow authors about this, and you and I have not yet got around to this. Yes. Because I actually believe that that despite the fact that there are, the largest selling category is still romance or thrillers, I really believe that the reading audience is, especially the younger generation, they are shifting to content. So It is a fact that for many authors, you know, your book literally gets a second life, or it gets a much wider audience the moment it's been adapted for the screen. You know, I think so. Almost every author is happy if your book is acquired. Yeah. And like my last book has been acquired recently by a big studio, and I'm looking forward to it, and also with trepidation, because you really hope that they've done justice, to what you've put there. But the fact is that that's where it gets a much, much wider audience. So that's true, and I don't know so many younger people who are reading books anymore, and they're also reading a lot more they are reading, but not necessarily books. And they're reading on their other devices. They're reading a lot more on different apps. So
reading apps and etc. So when you said that you've had a lot of discussion with different authors about content that needs to be tweaked, could you elaborate on that?
See, for example, if you look at the fact that if you look at content on what's happening on Netflix and other streaming media, you're seeing that definitely the characters, you're playing with characters who are less stereotypical. So while in our books we are definitely trying to look at situations and explore different worlds and all that, but the fact that your character could be a very average guy. I'm just saying average guy, as in he's not, your guy who's one super billionaire and who's all that, who's not necessarily one tall, hunky looking chap, which even if you were in a romance, you would still want to set out to define the parameters as, fitting the basic parameters of, I'm so sorry to say this, but, in terms of what the expectation of attraction is. But I think so that shift has not yet happened so much. In the printed form, And it's something that we all need to be aware of and, you know, look at.
Would you be thinking about making that shift in your work ahead?
I think so. And I think
exploring stories of same-sex partners, etc.
Those totally. And I have a couple. I mean, we all always have a couple of. I definitely have plots that are sitting there for even for the last 8 years. And this book also was a plot that I, you know, revisited and refreshed in my head, for sure. And I think that what happens. In fact, this was happening at a session that I had at the Gurgaon preview also. You know, where I actually feel more fortunate of not, I have a large readership and an audience, but I am not burdened by a publisher saying you have to write this because your reader is this.
Expecting
you know, so I don't have that. I think if anything I've learned is that I don't want ever to be talking down to my readers. I actually believe that slowly as I've been writing that a more intelligent kind of reader is being drawn to my books. And I look at that as a compliment. And if it's smaller, then so be it.
So, you know, what comes first in your head? Is it the plot or is it the character? Because, you know, myself being an author, I'm always fascinated by the writing journey and the writing experience of another author.
What is yours, Kanchana?
Actually, I start off with an idea of a basic idea of the story. And then the character comes. So then I flesh out the character very deeply. Mm. And I think both in my case, both of them happen simultaneously, because I am very much an ideas person. Possibly because this goes back to what I have been doing or had been doing for almost 18 years, writing for various newspapers, magazines, companies. Mm. So I have been an ideas factory. So it's just that one little idea just strikes in my head, and then I flesh it out. What about you?
Pretty similar. I think that it starts with the, you know, this is a story about, and if you had to say, I could, I think I use even like the way I used to do my advertising work. In advertising, if I was taking a brief from somebody, I would say, give me the basically, what do we want to do in this particular campaign? So if I look at this and I say, okay, basically this is a story about, and I would say, this happens and that happens, and this is how music cuts through emotional barriers and this and that. And then I start fleshing out the characters to very, very great lengths.
So how did the character of Ragini come across? Because she comes across as a very lively, spirited, yet layered, and she's a little impulsive, she's a little crazy. So is there a bit of Milan in it, or she's completely out of your imagination?
You know, I wish that I could be like Ragini. So I feel that, and I think that this is something which, you know, has happened when I've been discussing the book at these kind of platforms, that Ragini has been through so much. She had to, at 18, she had to have a situation where she was publicly humiliated on stage, where her half-brother, when her mom married again, her half-brother really pulls a dirty number on her. And she is made the laughing stock of a particular sammelan. Sangeet Sammelan that was happening. And then there is a scene of molestation that happens. And then she finds that her family does not support her. When she goes and tells her mom disbelieves her. And that's quite a defining moment for her when she realizes that she's got to stand up for herself. So this is something which I have learned much later in life. You know, where this thing of stop expecting your husband or your brother or your sister or your mother to stand up for you, you know. So let them do what, if they're not going to do it, you stand up for yourself. So her decision then to go away at a very young age, to then struggle, you know, to do all kinds of jobs. And this is how, a lot of people, when they want to do their thing, they have what they call typically in Bombay, say, na, meko struggle karna pada. So if you want to do something really bad and you have to go through it, she gets sorted out much earlier. So I'm not there yet, but I wish I could be, and I always want to be the person who could stand up for herself and not expect anybody else to be doing it. So that's one very important trait in her.
I quite like the character of Annie also. You know, she's a very important character in the story, but you've not really given her much importance. Why is that? You know, I just wish you had fleshed her out a little bit more, but she kind of stays a little in the shadows, not completely in the shadows, but, you know, was it purposely you did that, just to keep the focus on Andrew and Ragini?
Well, because there were also so many other subplots. There was what had happened with Ragini. There was what had happened, the fact that, you know, Ragini's mother marries, as I said, she marries this guy who is this big ustad of Delhi. And, you know, I wanted to explore that. And there's only so much space you have to do it. So I wanted to explore the mother's character. You know, on one hand, you would say, dekho, you know, this book is reflecting, you know, a liberalized India. There is a woman who's remarried. But at the end of the day, the patriarchy was so deep that that mother had no voice in that second marriage. You know, so I wanted to make sure I brought that out. So it's always a question of, if I need to do this, let me do this first, and something else may need to take a back seat. And we all have good friends, and it's not necessarily very important to the plot to say how that friendship happened. You know, just let's just start at the point that there is a good old friend who she could turn to. And there was also a very important relationship between Andrew and his father, which needed to be explored.
That was also a very interesting plot. I mean, the like father and son relationship. Usually, you know, one reads of a son and mother, or daughter and mother, as in your case. But here, the relationship of Andrew with his father is very complicated. So, you know, like, tell them a little bit about the angst Andrew had against his father and his mom, and you know, and the feelings that were bottled up inside him. I found that very interesting.
So let's not forget that I said that Andrew is, you know, half British. His mother was British. And Andrew's father met Sally and fell absolutely in love with her. Sally left everything to, you know, become, you know, to leave her home in England and be here. But her basic nature is of a very inward person who is not demonstrative. And Anand Arya, his father, is a man who has always believed that maybe she knows best, old school, you know, mom knows best about how to bring up children. So he is so crazy about his wife that it's a different side of love where the child feels excluded, you know. Andrew, the kid, has always just felt excluded from their love. And it gets worse after his mom dies, where his dad is so shattered that all he wants to do is revisit the places that he and Sally went to together and this and that. That more and more, Andrew is just becoming hardened. And then he has another relationship with a woman where she goes over the top completely. So he just believes that love is really quite a destructive emotion and is best stayed away from.
But you know, that is what I find a little surprising, because he was witness to his parents' intense love, passionate love for each other. So is that why he kind of turns away from love, because he feels excluded? Because, you know, I mean, if he has grown up seeing that love, then he should also want to have, you know, a partner like his father had in his mother, in his life.
But they sent him away very early to boarding school. He always felt as if he was, like, you know, not really needed. He was, they were traveling all the time, everybody has their reasons, right? So his mother always, she came from an army background, and she had been shuttled around to where, you know, from station to station, and she believed that the child needed stability. They were building their company. So their first real love and their real child was this pharmaceutical company were invested in, which ended up shaping him to become this guy who, you know, was just always kind of, all he had was this Indian ayah who gave him a lot of, you know, his love for India came because of her,
So Milan, what next after our song? What's the next story you're working on, or have you begun on something? Is something brewing in your head?
There is. And now this time I'm looking at something which is a historical fiction. Oh. So yeah, let's see. And so there's a lot of research that's going into it.
Will that also be a love story set in a particular period?
Just looking at how big a role love should play in that. So it's a little early to talk about it.
So, like, any particular time in history would you like to just tell us? Any particular historical?
This is for me. This book is going to be a bit about you know, kind of going back into my roots. And researching, I'm a Sindhi, and I have, you know, not yet written a book which is looking at the Sindhi culture and the Sindhi ethos. And I've grown up hearing stories of my father was, you know, conceived around the time of the Quetta earthquake, Baluchistan, in 1935. Okay. So the story is set somewhere there. I've already said a bit too much.
Great. So I think, you know, we're going to eagerly look forward to that. So I'll throw open the questions to the audience. I'm sure, and I hope you have. Yeah, please. We have a raised hand. Can someone give her the mic, please? She's there.
Yeah. I just have one.
Could you please just tell us your name first?
I'm Hema. I just have a practical concern, like given the context also, once you've decided the context and everything, how do you go about selecting names for your characters?
I can tell you a funny anecdote about how I named Andrew, which is not related to anything except for the fact that when I had written my first book, which was The Love Raga was the working title of this book at that time. And the person who was heading Harlequin, India, was going on pushing me and saying, I think you need to write that book more saucily. I believe your voice, you can write bolder and things like that. And I wasn't very convinced. And I was also, at that time, this was my first book. And I just wanted to first just be within my comfort zone and see, you know, if I really wanted to make it really bold or not. But he kept saying it, and he was coming probably maybe from an understanding of what he thought was, my voice, or was it that, from a marketing perspective and saying this might sell more or whatever. But I told him, I said, you say that, his name was Andrew. And I said, Andrew, you say that one more time and I swear I'm going to write one book definitely with one character called Andrew. And he was a pretty conservative, Chinese Canadian. And, he at that time just smiled and he couldn't resist it. A month later, he asked me again. So promptly, I started plotting out this book. I wrote it at great length. So Andrew ka name was there. I said, which is good. And wherever he is in the world, maybe he'll read it and he'll remember this incident. And that's it. And then for Ragini, I knew that because both her parents were coming from music. Her father was a harmonium player, small-time harmonium player in Shimla. And her mother was a person who was learning Hindustani and everything. So I thought that it's very likely that parents who are coming from such a deep musical background will want to choose a name which has a musical sound and feel to it. And that's how Ragini was named.
Anybody else? Do we have more questions? I hope so. Okay.
Hello, ma'am. I have two questions. I am a 3 books old writer and I feel... my first question is, what is more beneficial for a writer, to be a e-book writer or a print writer? First question is this. And second one, I want to ask...
We have some time.
I forgot.
Okay, so when you... I'm going to ask you a question back. When you say beneficial, what do you mean?
For the name and fame. For the name and fame and money. For the recognition.
Okay, so I would say, first of all, don't come from that place. Look at the book you want to write.
Okay.
If the book is, have you experimented with both the forms, e-books and
yes, ma'am. My first book got selected in the Hindi Academy and it got printed by themselves. But the second and third, I choose for, maine fir uske liye e-book chuna. Ke maine wo dono e-book mein dal di. Lekin mujhe ye lagta hai ke बहुत ही ज़्यादा दिक्कत आती है उसको प्रमोट करने में. तो पहली बात तो बच्चे पढ़ते नहीं हैं, और दूसरा जो पढ़ना भी चाहते हैं, हमारे यहाँ ये है, हिंदी तो कोई पढ़ना ही नहीं चाहता, बोलने की तो बात ही छोड़ दीजिए. तो फिर हम अपनी बुक को प्रमोट कैसे करें?
तो आई विल जस्ट जंप इन टू द कॉन्वर्सेशन एंड जस्ट बट इन सॉरी बट लेट मी जस्ट टेल यू वन थिंग दैट इफ यू आर थिंकिंग ऑफ मेकिंग मनी आउट ऑफ योर राइटिंग देन आई थिंक यू शुड स्टॉप राइटिंग एंड डू समथिंग एल्स. राइट ओनली इफ यू आर इनसेनली in love with words and you can't stay away from writing the story that's buzzing in your head. Do it only for the love of it. Paisa maan lo ki nahi aayega, because
even,
there is no money
even
in
fame
books.
You see, the thing fame. Is there may be yeah. so many good writers who may be thinking ke why has so and so got so much fame and opportunity and a platform which we don't have. I think that is really not in our hands, you know. What strikes a chord with somebody is
then
what
ma'am,
is good.
What can we do for promoting our books?
See, there are a lot of avenues on social media where you can promote your books, and you can hire book publicists, etc. But you know, I would again and again, at the risk of sounding repetitive, you should focus on writing the story. I'll just take a minute of your time and tell you that my second book, I submitted it to my publisher, HarperCollins, who had published my first book. They did not like the story and they rejected it. So I felt it was a very humiliating experience to be rejected after getting published by the same publisher. I rewrote the entire story. I trashed the entire story, 80,000 words, and I rewrote the story completely in a new way, 90,000 words in 5 months, and I resubmitted it to HarperCollins, and they fell in love with it, and they republished it. So you know what? Thank you so much. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, write for the love of it. Don't concern yourself so much with promotion and publicity. Pehle, you know, get the book right. I think,
and make sure you have a body of readers who will be honest with you and give you honest feedback. Because I think most people tend to fall in love with their own writing first.
Exactly.
And then you're going around with very high hopes. Not you, as in generally, all of us.
Yeah,
you know, all
right.
Of us take it personally the moment there is any critiquing. So you've got to have people who you trust, who you know are not coming from any other agenda but to help to improve your work.
Absolutely.
I have those.
Yeah. The lady there wants to ask another question.
I'm sorry, it sounded to me a little conflicting as to what you told her, because in the first instance your book got rejected and then you rewrote it so that it could sell. So were you equally passionate the second time that you wrote it? I mean, you just rewrote it so that it sells. So
no, so I did not see, you know, selling is different. I rewrote the entire story to kind of get the publisher that I wanted, and somewhere I realized that the first version was not good enough. But the second version that I wrote of the story, I stand by it absolutely 100%. Even if HarperCollins or any other big publisher did not accept it, I would still stand by it. So, you know, what is more important is that you be sure of what you have written and you stand by your work. So what I'm trying to get across is that, you know, don't concern yourself as to how many people are going to read it. I don't know how many copies of my book has sold. I'm not, you know, while that is a thought that sometimes occurs to me, but when you are writing, you should focus on writing.
And another thing, you know, is it's easy to say, but it has to become a habit, is not to compare yourself with anyone.
Yeah.
You can't compare and say, oh, why so-and-so got it all, like that person is so lucky and they're selling like so easily, or like everything is working for them. You don't know what's going on in anybody else's life. The only control you have is over what you can do. And you have to be able to, take the rejections. All of us have. She's shared one example. I have so many that I can tell you of work that has gone, 2, 3, 4 publishers have rejected it. One has come back and said, I like it, but can you rework it like this? And it's something that, you know, I know I need time to again revisit it. So I'm going to do it, but it's not closed at all. And I will come back and I'll revisit it. And again, it's another book in the pipeline. And, you know, there was a panel going on here, right? We had best-selling authors talking about various things. And we can't go around comparing anybody. There are times when we have sessions, and I can talk about sessions when I'm amazed at the full house I have and I wonder, you know, how did this happen? And there are times when, you know, we were laughing about it last night, some of us, and saying sometimes you've just had got 4 people, but you carry on. You honor those people who came out to hear you. They made that effort. They braved the traffic. Did everything. They're honoring you, and you must honor, even if there's one person. I remember when my second book came out, TikTok with 30, and the publisher had planned a couple of cities tour and launch and all that. I remember one particular time I went to a lit fest, and the venue had been changed, and now suddenly it was somewhere in Andheri versus somewhere else. And there were, and it was like a, not Kala Ghoda, but it was like a Kala Ghoda kind of thing, where there were multiple things going on, kahin pe music, kahin pe crafts, kahin pe art, and somewhere in one room also literary events were going on. And there were literally 2 people in that audience. And I went through the whole session in the 1 hour for those 2 people and felt deeply honored that they were there. They were engaged right through, you know.
Great, very good.
Yeah.
I think we have a question there.
मैं थोड़ा सा हिंदी में बोलूँगा, अंग्रेजी में नहीं बोलूँगा।
जी जी।
मैं पर्यटन का में लिखता हूँ, मेरी 7 किताबें छप चुकी हैं, 2 किताबों पर राहुल सांकृत्यायन पुरस्कार भी गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने दिया है, 2 पुस्तकें भारत सरकार की हिंदुस्तान की लाइब्रेरी में के लिए अप्रूवल है, अनुमोदन। मैं ये सोचता हूँ इससे पहले कि मैं, वो बेटी वहाँ पर जो बोल रही थी वो हिंदी में बोल रही थी, तो अगर अच्छा होता है कि आप उसका जवाब हिंदी में देती तो ये भी एक मोटिवेशन का वो है। पैसा बनाना, पैसा तो हिंदी के लेखक जो है ना अपने पल्ले से देते हैं और अपनी किताबें छापते हैं, दैट इज़ नॉट देयर मोटिव। मगर ये कि प्रोत्साहन देना हिंदी को, तो मैं ये सोचता हूँ संसद में भी ऐसे होता है, जहाँ भी होता है कि हिंदी का जवाब दिया जाए तो बेटी
आपका क्वेश्चन मैं आपका समझी नहीं।
हाँ क्वेश्चन में आई एम कमिंग, मेरा क्वेश्चन का ये मतलब है कि हिंदी को प्रोत्साहन हम तभी दे सकते हैं जब हिंदी का जवाब हिंदी में दिया जाए।
आपने बिल्कुल सही बोला,
ठीक है। नहीं दूसरी बात, ये दूसरी बात मैं कहता हूँ कि ये जो पर्यटन जो है सब्जेक्ट है ये बहुत ही विशाल है और हमारे देश के लिए बहुत ही लाभकारी भी है, तो उसके लिए आप क्या हमें सुझाव देंगी कि पर्यटन पे क्या लिखा जाए और क्या नहीं लिखा जाए? हमने तो सारे हिंदुस्तान को छाना है और हिंदुस्तान के बारे में लिखा है, तो आप ये हमें कुछ सजेस्ट कर सकते हैं कि हम जो आगे लिखें वो क्या लिख सकते हैं पर्यटन के लिए खास?
मैं ये कहूँगी कि आज का टॉपिक जो है हम उसी के ऊपर बात करें। आज का टॉपिक है कि रोमांस को किस तरह से ट्वीक किया जा सकता है या किस तरह से उसको बदला जा सकता है या क्या इसमें ज़रूरत भी है बदलने की या नहीं, या बदलाव आ ही रहा है। तो अगर उसके ऊपर कोई क्वेश्चन हो तो हम उसकी बात कर सकते हैं, क्योंकि शायद समय खत्म हो रहा है।
समय भी खत्म हो गया, सो लेट्स फोकस ऑन द क्वेश्चन। या यू हैव अ क्वेश्चन? नो, ओके, सो वी हैव टू रैप अप नाउ। ओके, सो इफ देयर नो मोर क्वेश्चंस एंड वी हैव रन आउट ऑफ टाइम, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस एंड थैंक यू मिलन फॉर शेयरिंग योर थॉट्स।
थैंक यू कंचना,
थैंक यू सो मच।